everyone. I'm Alison Berman, live with Singularity Hub, and we're at day two of Exponential Manufacturing in Boston. I'm here starting the day with John Hagel. John Hagel's the co-chair of Deloitte Center for the Edge. He's also the author of The Power of Pull and SU Faculty. John specializes in corporate innovation and has over 35 years of management consulting experience. Thanks so much for being here, John.
Great to be here. Thank you.
So let's start. Can you tell me a bit about Deloitte Center for the Edge? It's such a unique place.
Yeah. Well, the Center for the Edge is, it's a research center that's based in Silicon Valley, and we founded it 10 years ago. And the charter was basically identify emerging business opportunities that should be on the CEO's agenda but are not, and do the research required to persuade them to put it on the agenda. So by definition, if they're already asking about something, it's too late for us. We want to focus on the things they're not even asking about.
And so how do you sometimes find that thing that they're not even asking about?
The name Center for the Edge. We believe that actually emerging business opportunities start first on some kind of edge. It could be a geographic edge, like emerging economies, demographic edges, like younger generations coming into the workforce or the marketplace, or new edges of technology that are emerging that create new possibilities. So we spend a lot of time on various edges looking for patterns in terms of something interesting that seems to be emerging there, and that's where we focus.
That's fascinating. And so in your work, you work with tons of organizations. What are some ways that companies are able to successfully create innovations and then keep them in the company? Because I know sometimes it's very easy to go about innovation and then it dies.
Yeah, there are a lot of, lessons learned or principles in terms of what drives successful innovation. In my experience is part of it is innovation ought to be shaped by and driven by a view of the long-term destination. Where are you headed? What's the opportunity or challenge that you're addressing 10 years out? And structure and focus the innovation initiatives based on that sense of where you're headed. And part of it too is metrics really matter. And I think that from our experience, one of the key things to drive successful innovation is focusing on a pretty systematic view of the metrics that matter to the company. So starting with high level financial metrics, as an example, for a company, the biggest challenge may be revenue growth. Okay, drill down one more level to operating metrics. What's the challenge there? Well, the reason we're having trouble with revenue growth is because our customers are churning at a too rapid rate. Okay, drill down one more level to ask at the front line, what are the metrics that really are affecting that churn rate? And there it could be, again, in the example, our customer call centers are not doing an effective job of responding to customers' problems. When they call, they get frustrated, they leave. Okay, now I've got a focus to say, if I could innovate around how to more effectively respond to customer needs in the call centers, that's going to make a big difference to the overall company. I get the attention and respect of all levels of the company because we've focused on the metrics that really matter.
Mm-hmm. And it's interesting talking about focusing on the metrics. I know sometimes initially with corporate innovation, when it became extremely popular, sometimes it felt a bit willy-nilly, or people were just trying to make it happen. How do you think like scrappy efforts can still be helpful, that balance of being able to take risk and being metrics driven?
Well, I think, the metrics give you a sense of potential for impact. Then it's a question of, okay, the scrappiness. Let's be really creative, come up with some new approach that really could take us to a completely different level in terms of impact on those metrics, and create environments where that kind of risk-taking is actually not just permitted, but actually demanded of the people in the organization.
Yeah, that makes me think of Astro Teller at Google X, where they say, like, what have you failed on today?
Right, exactly. No, yeah. I think that's one of the big questions. And, I think it has, there are a lot of different kinds of impacts, but one of the shifts that we see in terms of driving innovation is the nature of leadership in a company. Today, the mark of a strong leader is somebody who has all the answers. No matter what question you have, that person has the answers. We're confident we've got the person who's got the answers. Our belief is in a world that's more driven by innovation, the most effective leaders are those who have the most powerful questions and who actually are willing to admit they don't have the answers.
Yeah.
But to say, if we could find an answer to this question, we would achieve something pretty amazing. So it's expressing vulnerability, it's willingness to take risk, ask for help. All of those are really critical to fostering an innovation culture.
And that seems so much more real than appearing as though you know everything when nobody knows everything.
Well, that's the point. I mean, one of the issues is trust levels are declining in institutions and leaders. And it's partly because we've been brought up to believe that you should have leaders who have answers to all the questions, but we know you're a human being. And if you're not willing to acknowledge that you don't, that you there are things you don't know, how can I trust you, right?
Yeah.
Because you're not willing to admit that you're vulnerable.
Yeah, that's so interesting. And so we've talked right now about some skills of leaders focusing on employees. What are some of the critical skills employees should have in today's world?
You know, I think it ties a bit back to the leadership, but one of the things that we see as absolutely essential to driving innovation is something that we call productive friction. And it's the notion that, you know, in this world of increasing efficiency that has driven business to date, friction has been bad. You know, you want everybody around the table to be completely aligned and in agreement on what we're doing. Our belief is actually, in this world, the most creative innovation ideas are going to come from friction, from having, first of all, diversity around the table, so it's not everybody from the same background and mindset, but more importantly, taking that diversity and saying, go at it, you know, confront each other. Feel free, if you disagree or if you have a better idea, confront.
Say something, yeah.
But do it with respect.
Yes.
Right? That's the productive part. Friction can be very dysfunctional if you don't respect each other.
Yeah.
But if you have that respect, you inevitably can come up with much more creative and better ideas and innovation than if you just had everybody from the same background sitting around the same table.
Yeah, that makes me think a little bit with the productive friction. Karen Watson at Singularity University, she talks about always assuming best intentions. I think that's so helpful because then when you see an area of friction, you can then approach it with that intentional, respectful, which is how you are a great teammate.
No, exactly. And I think part of it is aligning around the questions that really matter, right?
Yeah.
If we all have a sense that we're all focused on the questions that really matter, that builds respect to say, okay, we have some differences in terms of how to get there, but the point is we want to get there and we're all in agreement that's where we need to be headed.
It is such a pleasure talking with you, and your insights are just so sharp. So thank you so much.
Thank you. Appreciate it.